Welcome to EPG Pathshala. My name is Dr. M.N. Rajesh and I teach at the Department of History, University of Hyderabad. The title of the module is Women and Movements in Northeast India, and it's part of the paper Women and History. The author of this paper is Dr. J. Limayinla Awo, an independent research scholar from Nagaland. So the main aim of this paper is to familiarize students with the movements in Northeast India, particularly in the colonial and more importantly the post-colonial period, where we have a series of disturbances in Northeast India. And the contention of the paper is that one has to understand this region firstly before trying to understand these movements, and therefore it tries to give a holistic picture of the movements in relation to the troubled history and also the geography and the other important contexts that have led to the rise of these movements. So before we go on to study these movements, we shall have a small idea of Northeast India. Today, Northeast India is no longer known only as the land of seven sisters. It has increased to eight with the addition of Sikkim, which has received full statehood and is also part of Northeast India. So the seven sisters of Northeast India originally were Assam, Meghalaya, Manipur, Nagaland, Tripura, Mizoram, and now we have also Arunachal Pradesh, and now we have Sikkim. So these regions are part of the easternmost frontier of India and are sometimes studied as part of Southeast Asian history, particularly when one studies the history of Burma or what we call Myanmar. Similarly, when one studies Inner Asian history, particularly the history of Tibet, one also studies the history of Arunachal Pradesh because of its linkages with the Tibetan culture area. And it's more pertinent to say here that the 6th Dalai Lama, Sangyen Gyatso, was born in Arunachal Pradesh, the present Dalai Lama being the 14th Dalai Lama. So Arunachal Pradesh has a connection with Inner Asia, particularly the Tibetan culture area. And we also have some parts of Arunachal Pradesh in the easternmost extremities having connections with the People's Republic of China, particularly the region of Yunnan. We have three communities, that is the Mompa, Loba and the Lisu, which are found also in India and China, where they are known as the Moinba, the Loba and the Lisu. This is just a small example to illustrate the artificiality of borders which came up after the colonial period, which divided many ethnic communities and put them into different countries because of the presence of British colonialism and also because of other larger interests like state building exercises by China, and also the collapse of the Tibetan state, and also the dissolution of many different polities. These are actually the subject of a work which was recently authored, known as an Anarchist History of Upland Southeast Asia by James Scott, in which he gives an interesting concept known as Zomia, which we shall talk about later to understand this region in its proper perspective. Firstly, after talking about the seven states, that is the seven sisters and the addition of Sikkim to Northeast India, we see that they are all lying east of Bengal, with the exception of Sikkim, which is in the north, and they're separated from Bengal by a small piece of land which is known as the Chicken's Neck. Generally, people understand Northeast India as a homogeneous whole, which is very, very untrue. Northeast India has many different ecosystems and many different geographical locales, and therefore many different production patterns like hunting gathering, which is now on the decline, large-scale agriculture in the Brahmaputra Valley and also in the Imphal Valley. Then we also have Sweden agriculture, which is largely known as Jhum agriculture. We also have terraced agriculture practiced by some groups of the Angami tribes in Nagaland. Then we also have other societies which practice horticulture. Then we also have large element of fishing. So these are different forms of production which are there in the Northeast, and therefore there are many different tribal communities. We therefore come to the weight of history. Most of Northeast India came under colonial British control after the formation of the Bengal Presidency. The regions lying to the east were incorporated as part of British India, and beyond this, after Burma, lay the regions of China in the Northeast, and then we have Thailand, which was the only independent country in this part of the world. We had only three independent countries in Asia: Japan, Thailand and Iran. And most of Thailand was actually divided to make way for a new country, Laos, which later became known as Laos, as it is pronounced in French. So Burma shared a border and was also under the British control. So the region between India and Burma was largely forested and was frequently referred to as no man's land. So this no man's land was actually populated by many different groups who were referred to as tribes. So the British referred to certain groups of people as tribes. The question arises as to why are there no tribes in Europe, which was one important question put up by G.N. Devi or Ganesh Narayan Devi, a famous anthropologist who started the People's Language Survey of India. He says that the British actually, as like other colonialists, used the term tribe, which was not used in Europe, to show a group of people with a lower level of development, which they had assumed to be. So therefore we have tribes in Asia, Africa, North America, South America and Australia, but not in Europe. And therefore many of the groups of people in Northeast were therefore labeled as tribes by the British. And secondly, since they were also outside the system of state control by the polities like the Ahom polity, which was centered in the Brahmaputra valley based on fertile river agriculture of the Brahmaputra river and its annual alluvial flows, or the Meitei polity centered in the Imphal valley, out of which whose control extended only over the Imphal valley directly but nominally over the hill region. So these regions of the hills became a bone of contention, and it is this tension between the state societies and the quote-unquote non-state societies which became an important factor in the British administration. While the earlier polities like the King of Tripura or the King of Burma or the Chakma kings of what is known as modern day Chittagong hill tracts actually maintained loose suzerainty over many of the hill peoples like the Riangs, etc., the British state tried to bring them all under one apparatus and therefore started a different mission of raiding these regions. In addition to the British, we also have the presence of American missionaries, particularly the American Baptist missionaries who entered Nagaland, and also other missionaries who entered what is known as the Lushai Hills, which is today now known as Mizoram. So therefore, the impact of colonialism, missionary activity, the state-making process and integration with the Indian Union were all complex, and therefore this weight of history cannot be ignored. Now we go to Assam, which is one of the largest states in Northeast India. Assam is a very large state and has very different forms of production. Most of Assam is engaged in agriculture based on the flows of the Brahmaputra River, which is a lifeline of Assam. So we also have large areas which are actually pastoral regions, and the names of certain regions give us a hint. For example, the name Gwalpara comes from the term Gwala or a pastoral community. So in this region of Assam, which was integrated into the Indian Union after the fall of the Ahom dynasty, the problem starts mainly in the period following the collapse of the Bengal. That is in 1907, with the partition of Bengal, we have an influx of people into Assam following the Hindu-Muslim clashes. This was also the period which saw the rise of communalism. Now the question arises as to why should people largely perceive Assam as an important destination. Assam was seen as an important destination because of availability of free land. So most of this land were taken away for cultivation by the land-hungry Bengali peasants, and further most of the administrators in Assam were also from Bengal. So it became a sort of rebellion against a Bengali intelligentsia, which was also not only the ideological force but also the administrative force representing the British, which led to the stirring of Assamese nationalism. There was a flowering of literature in Assam. Assam also has a large number of tribes, and the largest tribe in Northeast India are the Bodos. One of the important peculiarity of the Bodo tribe is that the Bodos are classified as a plains tribe and not a hill tribe. So the Bodos are classified as a scheduled tribe but live in the large plains in the regions of northern Assam bordering the regions of Bhutan, particularly in the districts of Kokrajhar and the neighboring district of Udalguri. Now the problem of Assam is primarily centered on the Assamese, the Bodos and the Bengalis, who are also perceived to be the immigrants. The story of immigration starts, acquires a rapid pace, though it starts earlier, after 1947 with a large refugee crisis from East Pakistan when India was partitioned into India and Pakistan, that is after the exit of the British. So the focus of attention was on the West, particularly West Pakistan with the Punjab border, which also had a large refugee crisis that stretched the Indian state and also the Pakistani state. This was seen as one of the largest movement of people in the world, with 17 million people crossing over from Pakistan and 16 million people crossing over from India. Most of the people coming to India from Pakistan were predominantly Hindu and Sikh refugees from Pakistan, that is from West Pakistan, and from Bangladesh, which was after 1971, we not only have Hindu refugees who had come from East Pakistan, but also Hindu and Muslim refugees. So to complicate the problem of language, Assamese versus Bengalis, we also have a religious element. So this led to large-scale protests. But what was the initial spur of this protest is one question. The initial spur of the protests was the large rise in number of Bangladeshi refugees, particularly after 1971. So while many of them actually entered, because Assam, except for Guwahati and one or two important urban centers like Jorhat and Sibasagar, there were no large-scale urban centers. Most of them entered the rural areas and took away unclaimed land and started cultivating it. And also started cultivating land on temporary areas known as the chahars or the sandbars. These sandbars stretch for hundreds of meters in the Brahmaputra, and they are very fertile and are formed during every season, and they dissolve after the season when the Brahmaputra is in spate. But for this whole season, they guarantee two important crops and also vegetable crops. This became a bone of contention, because after 1971, when the census was held, the decennial census in India, the figures for the Bangladeshis or the refugees, as the Assamese called them, or the Bengalis as they would like to call themselves, started increasing in large number. This led to a demographic crisis. This demographic crisis was exacerbated by large number of rioting, and this rioting led to the articulation of demands by the Assamese, particularly the rise of ASU, or All Assam Students Union. The All Assam Students Union was a movement led by students from all sections of the Assamese society and centered in Guwahati and throughout Assam, and successfully campaigned for large reforms, which were granted only after breakdown of law and order and administration in Assam, which the central government had declared as a disturbed area for 5 years. It finally ended with the formation of a political party, the AGP, or the Assam Gana Parishad, and the signing of the Assam Accord. The Assam Accord was signed between the AASU and the central government, and it paved way for the return of normalcy in Assam. But police crackdown, large-scale participation of women, was another important aspect of this. In this particular aspect, women for the first time participated after the freedom movement in such a large scale in any public space outside their homes in the Assam movement. The importance of women's participation was because many of the men were arrested by the police, or they had been taken over for questioning, and therefore it was unsafe for men. So women also used many different cultural forms like songs, dances, and spread of literature to mobilize and also start ideological movement to enlighten the people. Now, with this, the Assam movement now ensured a period of peace and democracy. But then we had the splintering of this movement, and then articulation by different voices like the Bodos, who are the largest tribe, as I had already mentioned, to which we shall come to after some minutes. The next important movement was the rise of the Mizo National Front in what was known as the erstwhile Lushai Hills. Before the 1971 Reorganization of State Act, Assam was the largest state, and many of the states of Northeast, which we find today on the map, were only part of Assam as districts. So the Lushai Hills was one particular such district, and the immediate cause for rioting or disturbed conditions in Lushai Hills was because of the bamboo famine. The Mizo region, or the Lushais as they were known to the British, but now prefer to call themselves the Meso, are a group of people centered in the Mizoram Meso Hills, and bamboo is one of the most important part of their everyday life. What happens with the bamboo is that during the flowering of the bamboo, which takes place during the 30 or 40 years cycle, we have a large scale increase in population of rats. So the death of the bamboo after the flowering, the increase in population of rats led to famine like conditions, and this famine like conditions led to a serious crisis of food and then breakdown of the village communities, which therefore resulted in a battle for survival. This battle for survival led to the formation of a, in 1996, the Meso National Famine Front was rechristened as the Meso National Front, and it started an agitation. This agitation was primarily for the immediate relief from the rat population and destruction of crops, or what was known as mautam or the bamboo flowering. And the immediate voices to the central government and the state government went unheeded. Lal Denga was the leader of the Meso National Front, and his voice and appeal from the government did not meet with much response. Later, what happened is that there was a starting insurgency, and it led to bush war. It met with reprisal, and this two-decade-long agitation, which started in 1966, went on with the Indian Army and also the state police of Assam agitating. Finally, under the impetus of Rajiv Gandhi, who was the then Prime Minister of India in 1987, and also talks facilitated by the church and also by many other non-governmental organizations and interested parties, talks were held, which finally resulted in the giving up of guerrilla activities, and police action was stopped. During this particular period, some of the important aspects which led to women becoming part of the Meso movement were the large-scale arrests of men and also their incarceration. So many of the families were left with single home families, in which women who already were unencumbered by patriarchy, unlike in other regions like Assam, they were already part of the public life, had to actually not only look after the family and be the mother, but also be the father. And it is also noteworthy to mention today that Mizoram is one of the only states in India which is having 100% literacy. So we have therefore a large number of literate women. Many of them were schooled during the insurgency period in Mizoram on a large diet of literature. This particular flowering of literature also started and was very interestingly spread through large and remote parts of the Meso region, and also in the neighboring Chin Hills of Burma, where the Meso people had their, particularly the Chin group of people with whom they shared bonds of mutually intelligible language, was simply because of the adoption of Roman script and the rise of a print culture. So the guerrilla activities were now not only done by men, but also women took large part in this, and women also started entering the public sphere. So with the entry of women in the public sphere, they now staffed many of the offices, the post offices, All India Radio, many other offices, and also started managing property and looking after the family. Establishment of peace in 1987 after the Meso Accord between Lal Denga and Rajiv Gandhi, the then Prime Minister of India. Thus, the Meso movement, which was mainly focused on battling the famine and led to a police action and broke out into full-scale insurgency, led to the presence of women in large scale. And this presence of women and their entry into public sphere changed the whole fabric of the Meso society, and also their schooling in militancy and the formation of the Meso National Front. The story ended with the Meso National Accord, and today Mizoram is one of the most peaceful places in Northeast India, with the highest rate of literacy in India. We now move on to the next state, Nagaland. Nagaland is a state which lies to the north of Mizoram and borders the Naga Hills in Burma. And the story of Nagaland is a bit complicated than Mizoram, as the Nagas aspired for autonomy in 1944. After independence in 1947, the Naga issue was unresolved, and it was more political in nature, unlike the Meso issue, which was immediate outpouring was because of the famine. The Naga issue lapsed into armed revolt, which also met with swift action, and this action and guerrilla warfare continued for many years, and a breakthrough was achieved in the 1975 Shillong Accord, which created the state of Nagaland from the Naga Hills, which was part of Assam. So the new state of Nagaland was established with its capital at Kohima. Another important city of Nagaland is Dimapur. A new university was also established. The most important aspect of the 1975 Shillong Accord is the autonomy given to Nagas in terms of customary laws. So whenever there is any conflict between the laws of the Indian Constitution and the customary law shall prevail. However, while many groups which were led by Fizo, who had started the movement, and some of the groups which broke away took part in the peace issue, some of them did not fully adhere to the peace, and the NSCN, or the Nationalist Socialist Council of Nagaland, did not fully adhere to the peace accord and still continue to maintain a state of conflict. Though there have been some talks, and then this NSCN has now entered into ceasefire. But how did this ceasefire happen? There are fights going on and clashes going on and large-scale skirmishes going on between the security forces and the NSCN, which led to a large number of killings. It was at this particular moment that a new organization known as the Naga Mothers Movement stepped in to restore a ceasefire. The Naga Mothers Movement were concerned about many things, particularly the large-scale consumption of alcohol, which led to the banning of alcohol in Nagaland, and also the large-scale disappearance of what they called a generation, the young generation, which was a lost generation. So to stop militancy, therefore, they pleaded for a ceasefire. So the Naga Mothers Movement exerted pressure on the church, and including the church and the elders, they started this movement for peace, and which has now led to a ceasefire. Nedunu Nuvu Angami of the Naga Mothers Movement and Themsula Avo, who is a well-known literary figure and also recipient of one of the important awards in India, are well-known figures who have played a great role in the Naga civil society. It is because of the efforts of these important personalities that we have the rise of many important interventions, particularly of women in the Naga movement. So today, when we talk about the Naga movement, the talks are not only between the Indian government and the state government of Nagaland and the NSCN, but also the Naga Mothers Association, which is an important stakeholder in this whole process. This emergence of the Naga Mothers Association as an important stakeholder has also led to their voicing of certain concerns, particularly in theology, because Nagaland is a Christian majority state, and also in other aspects of life, particularly the banning of alcohol and many other aspects, and also the promotion of education, which has also led to the establishment of the Nagaland University, which was part of the Shillong Accord. We go to Meghalaya, with Shillong, which was the capital of Assam, and after the redrawing of the political map in 1971, the establishment of the state of Meghalaya, Shillong became the capital. The two important ethnic groups here are the Khasis and the Jaintias, and the along with the Garos. The Khasis are a materially local tribe, and they have protested in large numbers against the unsound projects that are ecologically harmful. As the name Meghalaya suggests, it is the abode of clouds, and Chirapunji is the only region which is known as the wettest region on the face of planet Earth. But today Chirapunji is fast on the way to becoming a story of an ecological disaster, which has led to the Khasis and other groups campaigning for ecological justice, and therefore the immediate culprit and target is the illegal logging. And thus, one of the important successes which is achieved by women here are the traditional laws of inheritance are guaranteed. The traditional laws of inheritance are guaranteed for the Khasis makes much meaning, because they are not only matrilocal, that is, in the residence is not only local, but it is also matrilineal. Though the residence now is also becoming patrilocal in terms of monogamous families, but the society is matrilineal, that is, lineage is through the women. We now next go on to another important state, Manipur. Manipur is one of the most important states in Northeast India, and is also a very complex state where we have two important systems of production, that is the Imphal Valley, which is a plain land where agriculture predominates, and we have the hills where we have large number of the Naga population and also the Kuki population practicing Sweden agriculture. The focus is primarily on the Meitei or the Manipuri speaking people who populate the Imphal Valley, and the continuing militancy was also because of the problems of integration with the Indian Union as after the transfer of power and the princely state of Manipur became part of India. Though there were only some stirrings, the main problem came after 1974 with the rise of militancy. So now the reaction from the women were in a very creative way known as the formation of the association known as the Meira Paibis. The Meira Paibis are a group of association of women who spring up suddenly, and what is interesting is that they have used the traditional cultural resources to assert their protest, particularly in the form of songs, dance, associations, and significant pressure on governments and progress is initiated. Literary festivals are also held. With this, there is also a drawing upon the traditional cultural themes and resources leading to revival of the traditional Meitei culture. And one of the important achievements here is that the shift from the Bangla script or the Bengali script back to the earlier Meitei script or the Meitheilon script of the Manipuris. And finally, we also find one important personality, Irom Chanu Sharmila, who was till recently on hunger strike and was being force-fed for holding a fast for the repealing of the Armed Forces Special Act in Northeast India, and has been given recognition as one of the persons who has been on fast for a very long period. Now, it would not be out of place if we talk of the return to the disturbed conditions and why they are part of the hill regions. As we were talking about the region of Zomia, when we look at the map of Asia, we find that there are two classifications of Asia, that is mainland Asia and maritime Asia. Maritime Asia includes the regions of the island states of Philippines, Indonesia, Malaysia and Singapore, whereas mainland Southeast Asia includes Burma, Laos, Thailand and Vietnam plus Cambodia. Now there is a new intervention known as Highland Southeast Asia. So we have mainland, highland and maritime. Highland Southeast Asia is the region of mainland Southeast Asia which excludes the state societies. Most of the people living in the highland Southeast Asia are quote unquote tribal people or people who have fled the state making process, to use the words of James Scott, author of the book The Art of Not Being Governed. Scott has called this particular region as a region of refuge from the state making process, in which he says that there was no permanent state, there are only loose associations. And this region, he says, extends from Northeast India to Vietnam. However, the coining of this term was originally done by William Van Schendel. It is here that we have different levels of patriarchy operating, because women, unlike in state societies, could not be fully subjugated. This explains for the independence of women. However, after the formation of nation states and after World War II and their coming to fruition, the concept of Zomia has ended. But it is one of the residues of this process continue. However, this is one of the most important interventions due to the fact that it explains why this region evaded the state and the state making process, and therefore explains the special need to be taken. The author of this concept of Zomia was William Van Schendel, who earlier in 2002 included the region from Northeast India to Vietnam. Later he also included Eastern Tibet. And in 2007, he extended this region to as far as Afghanistan. So we have the regions of large regions of mainland Southeast Asia with the exclusion of the Brahmaputra Valley, the Imphal Valley or the fertile valleys in Tripura or the fertile Irrawaddy Valley in Burma. And we have the large number of the hill regions as part of this Zomia. So this explains the two important facts, the roots of dissatisfaction with the state and also the large-scale participation of women, as they were not burdened with the patriarchy, but they were always part of the production process and therefore they were always in contact with other men. Finally, since there was no state making process and no literary tradition, they were also not burdened by any large scale laws, and it was only the traditional laws of the chieftains that mattered to them, and the institution of chieftaincy itself was very loose. We have come to the 8 states of Northeast India, and we have seen that most of this region was in a state of disturbed condition because of certain political reasons and also because of certain administrative problems. And in this process of reconciliation and the soul searching by various sections of the society, but by the government, the administration, by the media, many explanations and advances have been given, and new endeavors have also borne fruit, like we have seen in the case of the Assam Accord, the Mizo Accord, the Shillong Accord with regard to Nagaland. And there are also many new movements coming up. So on one side, we have seen that while the administration has tried to reach out to the people and new accords are being implemented, large-scale participation of women and women's pressure was also there among in these accords, particularly in the case of Manipur. We have the Mera Pai Base, or we have the Women's Naga Mothers Association, who are instrumental in getting all concerned parties to the table. And finally, the explanation for the large-scale participation of women in public life is not only as a response to the growing militancy, as in the case of other regions, but also because they could draw upon their indigenous cultural resources, which already had given space to women, particularly in the regions of Zomia, which we had talked about, where women were free from other laws of patriarchy, which did not bind them like their sisters in other regions. With this point, I would like to conclude that all these aspects have to be taken in totality to understand Northeast India, and particularly the contribution of women to these movements. Thank you.